We're still in the sixth chapter of Ephesians. This, I think, is the eighth week working in this series of verses 10 through 20 in Ephesians chapter 6. Best known to all of us who read the Bible as the armor of God section at the end of Paul's letter to the church in Ephesians. And I want to just point out the verse that we're working from, and I want to read the whole list of pieces of armor that are here. In fact, I want to read right from the first verse. 10, verse 10, down to the 20th verse. Finally, be strong in the Lord and in the strength of His might. Put on the whole armor of God, that you may be able to stand against the schemes of the devil. For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the cosmic powers over this present darkness, against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly places. Therefore, take up the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all, to stand firm. Stand, therefore, having fastened on the belt of truth, having put on the breastplate of righteousness, and as shoes for your feet, having put on the readiness given by the gospel of peace. In all circumstances, take up the shield of faith, with which you can extinguish all the flaming darts of the evil one, and take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God, praying at all times in the Spirit with all prayer and supplication. To that end, keep alert with all perseverance, making supplication for all the saints, and also for me, that words may be given to me in opening my mouth boldly to proclaim the mystery of the gospel, for which I am an ambassador in chains, that I may declare it boldly as I ought to speak. And may the Lord add His blessing the reading, hearing of that word. We're reaching and we're at the last part of the armor that's listed in this section of Scripture. Sometimes referred to as the only piece of armor that has an offensive use, an offensive as well as defensive bit of armor. And what we look at it, when we look at the text, it's the sword of the Spirit that we're looking at, which is the Word of God, Paul says. The sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God, which I don't think means that the Spirit wields the Word, but I think it means that the Word is supplied by the Spirit, that it is coming to us by the work of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit, very involved in the work of a believer and the life of a believer. The Holy Spirit regenerates. The Holy Spirit changes us on the inside, brings Christ's revelation to us, teaches us what we haven't gotten yet, opens the truth to us. Revealing work on the inside. So what we're looking at is a sword of the Spirit, pretty good metaphor, which is, Paul writes, the Word of God. The sword that the Spirit supplies. The sword which is put into the Christian's hands as a gift of God. Both helmet of salvation and sword of the Spirit gifted to us. This being the last mention of it in the text. So the first question we have to ask, and I'm not going to labor this one, hopefully. What is represented by the Word of God in this place? The sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. What is represented by that? And sometimes our first answer is the Scriptures. I like answering with the Scriptures. Are the Bible, the Word of God, Don't we call the Bible the Word of God? Sure we do. Say, bring your sword with you. I used to have a little New Testament. I still have New Testaments, and I carry them around sometime, and I always call them my little pocket knife. They just have part of the message. So, you know, instead of saying it's part of the Scripture, it's a little pocket knife, which gets the job done one-on-one. You know, it's up close. You can use it. On the whole, we can say Scriptures, and that's true. Because all Scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for whatever needs there are in the human being. Whatever. On the whole, then, it is true to refer to this as the Scripture. And there are two Greek words that I want to mention to you, because these are the two words that you're going to find in the New Testament that translate word. One is logos. Are you familiar with that one? Logos. Logos is the one used 325 times in the New Testament. And it's translated in a lot of different ways. It's not always word. Sometimes it's translated other words: subject, matter, thing, statement, declaration, speech, message, proclamation, saying, spoken, talk, all forms of logos. Translated many different ways. Now, word is the superior one, the one that shows up more than the others in the New Testament word. Now, there's another word in the New Testament that's translated word, and that's rhema. How many are familiar with that one? Logos, rhema. And I think it has to be noted, and I can't prove this, but it looks like in the use that we have in this sixth chapter of Ephesians, where it talks about the Word of God, being the sword of the Spirit, being the Word of God, that what is meant here is a word spoken, a spoken word. We're talking about a Word of God that's going to be a sword. And that there's lots of pieces of the Word of God, fragments of truth that are used in conversation, in prayer, in practice, in living. Now, here's what I want you to also understand, though. Logos and rhema overlap a lot when you read the New Testament. In fact, they sometimes seem to imply the same meanings. They seem, in other words, rhema sometimes shows up to be a representation of the whole of Scripture. Logos shows up to be a representation of the whole of Scripture a lot more often, because it's in the New Testament a lot more often. But these words overlap with each other as they're used in the text. Maybe that'll come through as we get going on this. Notice I said maybe, because I'm not sure where I'm going except with the Holy Spirit guiding through this stuff. So I want us to understand that as well. Both the Old and the New Testaments are known by Paul as the Word of God. The word that was added, the New Testament writings that came and were later added, Paul would have said amen to their addition. He understood these were words spoken by God through people. There were prophecies of old, yes. And there were continued words that were given, letters, forms that God inspired and end up in your Bible. Letter to the Ephesians. Paul writing from prison. Was that inspired Scripture? I have to believe it was. Revealed by the breath of God, it's still in the book. And the church had to make those decisions as they worked through written Scriptures and all the extras there were in the early life of the church, those early years. So the dominant idea is that the Word equals two things if you use logos in the New Testament. And that is this: the gospel message, the Word of God. Everybody agree with that? The gospel message is the Word of God. Jesus Christ is the Word of God. You agree with that? That's pretty clear in Scripture. So we have two things here, New Testament usage, that we can underline: the gospel message and Christ himself. And the best place to get that started is in John 1. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. It's a reference to Jesus Christ himself, God who became man. Okay? Son of God become man. Luke, more than any other gospel writer, viewed the Logos as the gospel message. And when he did that, he recognized the word as the message about Jesus' death, resurrection, ascension, about his power, about a desire to forgive sins, about his summons to godly living. All of that in the message of Jesus. All of it together can be called the gospel. This is the life of Jesus with all the parts of it that's there. See, sometimes people say, we're preaching the gospel, but they don't explain it to the point that you can understand it's the gospel. I had a friend call, or wrote a letter actually this week, and in that letter, he said, we got a new pastor in our church. The other pastor stayed here 19 years. We got a new pastor. He's 34 years old. He's had some, I'm assuming he was part of church staff out of seminary, and then he's ready to go. He said he's been here quite a little while now and haven't had one sermon with the mention of Jesus or the gospel. Not one. Now see, we have to be careful when we talk about we preach the gospel. Are we in the middle of the story of Jesus? Do we trust in him? Do we know who he is? Do we understand what he came to do? Do we understand that he's doing it? Do we know that he's at the right hand of God? He's coming back to finish what he started. The gospel is the power of God unto salvation. And I'm crying out to God saying, Lord, I want to see that again in manifestation. If it's the power of God, maybe I need to look at what I'm preaching. Maybe we need to think about how we're hearing it. Or maybe we need to think about how we're seeking God for the power that goes with the message. Because the power of God transforms sinners. Doesn't it? Transform sinners. That's the power of God. This gospel centers in Jesus Christ. Now, when you go to the Old Testament, you get this Word of God language about a man on a horse, a white horse. In the 19th chapter of Revelation. Now, I don't know how you like Revelation with all of its imagery, but I like that imagery. It's kind of fun. It's potent. It leads me to worship when I recognize what's revealed in it. Let me just point out a little bit of this. Just because we're just family today, you know, as we always are. Then I saw heaven open, and behold, a white horse. The one sitting on it is called Faithful and True. And in righteousness he judges and makes war. His eyes are like a flame of fire. On his head are many diadems. He has a name written that no one knows but himself. He's clothed in a robe dipped in blood. And the name by which he is called is the Word of God. Living Word. The armies of heaven, arrayed in fine linen, white and pure, were following him on white horses. From his mouth comes a sharp sword with which to strike down the nations, and he will rule them with a rod of iron. Rod of iron. He will tread the winepress of the fury of the wrath of God the Almighty. On his robe and on his thigh has a name written, King of Kings, Lord of Lords. There's a vision for you. Isn't it? Wow. John would have to, I would think, pause for a moment and think about it. What he'd just seen. He's the one seeing. Trying to grasp. Trying to understand. Can you picture Jesus coming back again with a sword out of his mouth? Flame coming out of his eyes? Power and the potency? Now, if we're not careful, we get caught up in a sentimental picture of Jesus. Meek and mild, gentle Jesus who saved us by his submission to the death and the resurrection that seals the reality of our justification as he goes to the right hand of the Father and makes possible the fullness of salvation. Hey, if he's coming back as King of Kings and Lord of Lords, you can look for the sword coming out of his mouth. You're looking for words that come to judge the wicked in order to save his own. He deals with sin and sinners in the powerful way of judgment. Mounted on a white horse, none other than Jesus Christ, faithful and true, King of Kings, Lord of Lords. So in the New Testament, we've got this word of God that comes and meets our needs, saves our souls, coming through the church, becomes an instrument for salvation to others. We've got all of that. But we have to remember that in the Old Testament, we can look around and see some pretty potent things. And when we come to Revelation, here is the King and the final analysis of all things, establishing his kingdom, establishing who he is. Ideas converge in the New Testament. Jesus, the eternal Word, becomes God incarnate. In the New Testament, we get this story. He does and says what his Father says. He's the Old Testament realization of the prophetic words of God through the prophets. This is the fulfillment of the prophetic in the Old. He's the creative Word who creates new life in the believer. His power sustains. His Word saves us. Secondly, the word with which believers are entrusted is none other than the same message of salvation as was entrusted to the early disciples. Same message. Gospel still being preached, and the word is the announcement of God's final speaking to us, not through prophets now all the time, through his Son. Remember Hebrews? Right at the very beginning of the book of Hebrews, let me get there. Hang on. Long ago, at many times and in many ways, God spoke to our fathers by the prophets. Looking back at God's beginning, calling out an Abraham, adding lives and Abraham's descendants, the true believers, finally all coming in when we see it done. But in these last days, he has spoken unto us by his Son, whom he appointed the heir of all things, through whom also he created the world. He's the radiance of the glory of God, the exact imprint of his nature, and he upholds the universe by the word of his power. And making purification for sins, he sat down at the right hand of the majesty on high, having become as much superior to the angels as the name he has inherited is more excellent than theirs. That's him. He who came as the Word to speak and to accomplish redemption. Prophets leading up to him, he fulfills the prophetic story. That's who he is. And we as true believers in him are responsible to proclaim his word, his message, which he is in the center of in the wholeness, the gospel, to those who do not know him. We have a job, calling to do that. A calling to do it. Long ago, at many times in many ways, God spoke to our fathers by the prophets. If you look at the early Christian teachers or the teaching and preaching in the early part of the church, Book of Acts, beyond, you'll find that they had no hesitation in taking the sacred name, the Word of the Lord, to describe the message they spoke. They didn't beat around the bush and say it was something else. It was the Word of the Lord. And when they first were in trouble in Jerusalem and they were imprisoned for a moment and then released and they went and had their prayer meeting, they asked God to give them the ability to preach the Word with boldness. Why? Because they knew that was the message. That Word of the Lord would transform those who heard them as the Holy Spirit did His work through the message. May God bring us to a point again and again where we stop and say, okay, Lord, I know the power is in the gospel. May it be primary in me, may it be primary through me and through this congregation. May we again realize if we just get to speak the name of Jesus for a little while to someone, we sit down with coffee and we talk about that great salvation plan to any degree. It is the power of God and the gospel that will bring it home. It's not us who bring it home. We just deliver it to them. We speak it, we preach it, we say it. And God takes it right into the heart, transforms lives. Throughout Acts, the book of Acts, the preached gospel is designated as the Word of God. Preached gospel all the way through. All the way through. Now, I have to ask this question and get us a chance to think about it. I grew up, as many of you did, in churches where we always said this. The Lord told me. This and that. How many of you have had those experiences? Don't be afraid now. I've got my hand up. Because sometimes something happens, you hear something or a word is spoken to you, maybe through somebody else, maybe in your own heart, that you just know is true. Don't let me lose you. What Jesus did, and this is what Martin Lloyd-Jones was strong in, and I love that guy in his preaching. And Martin Lloyd-Jones makes it pretty clear that he believes that the word you're going to hear is Scripture. Martin Lloyd-Jones is not going to accept the fact that the Word of God can be anything outside of Scripture. So in that understanding, you cannot say, I got a word from the Lord, and it just kind of is words other than Scripture. That's a safe position, and for a lot of people, that's where we live, and may be true most of the time. I would say it is. I've seen too much subjectivity when it comes to being led or being this, that, or the other by the Word of God. Many of you have. But listen to this. Here's what he said. What the apostle is saying, this is Lloyd-Jones, is this. Take up the sword which the Spirit Himself provides for you. And I totally agree with that statement. It's a great statement. That is to say, the Word of God. Yes. In other words, the Scriptures, the Bible. And then if Lloyd-Jones were here, he'd tell you this story. He said, Jesus was baptized in the Jordan by the Spirit. John baptized him. The Spirit came out of heaven shaped like a dove, landed on him, anointed him, and all of that. And the very next thing that he gets is a trip to the wilderness. And so he would tell you this story like I'm telling you. Then he ends up in the wilderness, and he's sent there to be tempted by the devil. That's the purpose. He's going to face the enemy at the very beginning. And he's going to fast 40 days. He's going to be hungry. So the first temptation makes sense. When he's enticed to turn rocks into loaves of bread. Hey, Lloyd-Jones, sit down right here and turn that. You know, Lloyd-Jones says, Jesus says, sit down right there, turn that rock into bread. That's what the devil told him to do. How did he answer him? How did he deal with it? Ah, it is written. Chapter 8, verse 3, Deuteronomy. Man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. What did he recognize, first of all? He recognized that what he was hearing was not from the mouth of God. He'd not heard from the enemy the word of God. But he knew the word of God, and it rises in his thinking, and he's ready to use it. Then he's invited, you know, the worship thing and the jumping off a cliff thing, all those deals, and each time he answers from Deuteronomy. Chapter 6, 13, 16, two places. And says, is it written every time? It is written every time. It is written every time. And you know, one of the things that we've done around here, what I've tried to do is keep telling you, if you read the Psalms prayerfully, you will find yourself accumulating a language for prayer. You'll find yourself with words that you can turn into prayer as they become more and more familiar to you. You can't pray better than the prayers in the Bible, inspired by God to be there, prayed by people in trouble or people in frustration or whatever kind of need there was. So whether we're reading the Psalms and meditating on them and praying them, or whether we're reading the whole of the Bible, of any part of it, isn't it possible to turn that into prayer? Isn't it possible that we can know the Bible well enough that when we know we're in a warfare and the enemy has come against us, to quote Scripture to him? Yes. I was raised in a little full gospel church. So I have a hard time saying he can't speak outside of Scripture. Because I think the gifts of the Spirit are still possible. Because the Holy Spirit's not done. And when God wants to do something, what does the Bible tell us? It tells us he can do it. The problem is when we get into such a strong pursuit of things that are more controversial, we lose sight of the overall size of this, the beauty of it. Just let God work. Let him work. I talk to my... As a man, I pastored for 1 month in 1986. It was a downturn year in Midland. It was my first year in Midland. Grace and I moved there in January of 86, and the oil business went straight down. And so I was in a troubled church anyway. It was a divided church, and the maiden part of it, the part that was still there, wanted me to come pastor, so I ended up saying yes. And in the midst of that year, we lost 75 people who were engineers and whatever with the oil business. And it just drifted down. We had about 270, 80 people there, and went down about 200, about as low as it got, and then it started up. Then it was good. God did his work. Oil was still $12 a barrel or whatever early on. And it was interesting. But I met this guy. He was there the first thing. He'd come and talk to me. And we'd sit down at the restaurant. He'd light his pipe. And he'd say, how do you know you're called to preach? Every time. I met with him probably four or five times over the next few months. He moved in October, so I only had him from January to October. And he called me from Pennsylvania. How do you know you're called to preach? I want to ask you again. Nothing new, man. If you can do anything else in the world, go do it. If you're still badgered by preaching, you might want to start thinking a different direction and look at it. So he kept calling me. He called me about everything that happened in his life, and pretty soon he's going to Elam Bible Institute training to be a pastor. Ended up being a pastor for 15 years, and this about a year ago moved to Katy. I hadn't seen him since 86 in Midland. I just talked to him every once in a while. All through those years, he'd call. So we've been having a little time to sit down together. But when I talked to him, you know, he comes from the strong, charismatic effort and prophetic, I always hear about the prophetic. And I don't fuss about that. I believe the Holy Spirit can do whatever he wants to, but I do think that if we don't get back to the hold on to the scriptures and develop in our minds the Word of God so that we know what the Word teaches, so we can take the Bible and use it as part of that weaponry. The Word of God, the sword of the Spirit. It is the best defense there is and the greatest offensive, life-changing way. And when the Word of God is spoken and shared, you don't have to worry about it tracking off. It's just going to change some lives and make a difference. It's going to make a difference. The preached gospel. I like that story by Lloyd-Jones. I like him using that text in Matthew, which is the one I read a while ago, with the temptations that came his way, and every time he had the word in him, the truth in him. I don't use Deuteronomy much as a text for someone. Do you? I don't fight the enemy with Deuteronomy. I go back and fight the enemy with New Testament stuff. That's just how we get, because the New Testament has established marvelous, marvelous reality and foundation and salvation life all the way along. The sword that is spoken of in the text, Makaron, I don't know if I pronounce that right or not. I pronounce every Greek and Hebrew word like a Texan. So, however it is. But it's a word meaning sword. And there's another word meaning sword, but it's not the one that used. And the other word meaning sword is a real sword. But this word is a small sword. It's kind of like a hand knife. It's not a sword at all. Maybe like sharp, like a surgeon's scalpel. Or like a butcher's best knives. Or a priest who has to handle the offering given, animals, or something like that. The scripture that I read to you a while ago from the 4th chapter of Hebrews, where it says, the word of God is living and active, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing to the division of soul, spirit, of joints and marrow, discerning the thoughts and intentions of the heart, and no creature is hidden from his sight. The word of God is living and active. When it mentions sword in here, it's the same word. Mentions sword. The beauty is that this little sword's function is to discern the heart, to lay open the secret intentions and thoughts of the heart, to cut through everything right to the core of a person's life. All the way. Now, if you're using that as kind of a weapon, using the Word of God in that way, what do you expect that word, like a sword, like that kind of sword to do? Open, open. Open the heart to the fresh Word of God. Open the life before that Word. Make them ready to hear. Ready to respond. Surgeon at work. What happened when you were born again, using some subjective beginning? You know, I tell you mine all the time and don't give you a shot at it. But how many of you knew that when your life was touched by the Word of God in redemption, when it started, when the knife came in, the Word, like a knife, came in, Did it change anything? Did it open you up to anything? Did it make you desire, hunger for anything? Because when you look at this, it just takes it all one cut right to the centerpiece of it all. Discerning, piercing the division of soul and spirit, of joints and marrow, discerning the thoughts and the intentions of the heart. That's right down from the outside, right through to the inside, opening you up before God. Will that same word, used as defensive and offensive weaponry as we live for Jesus, affect others as we live and bear witness to the gospel? As we speak it, as we share it, as we say it, will God use that to open up somebody? Yes, He will. Some of us can remember those rare times when God just did that. He just opened the person you were talking to. And they were broken, they were open, they were ready to know Him. Their lives were changed. Changed. It's great when you see it happen to your children. They're born again. Daryl was ADD. ADHDDD. I don't know how many D's. And he was fun at times. The kid had a brilliant mind. He just never used it. Don't tell him I said any of this when you see him. Didn't use it. Baseball cards, he collected them. He had some pretty pricey ones. He had a whole bunch of nice cards. He knew every batting average from every year, from every player, from every team. When he was first played, first year, first season, whether he was a rookie or not, when he was a rookie, and all of that. And he never made good grades in school. He didn't try, didn't work hard at it. C's were great for him. Until he began to read the Bible and the theologians that worked it. Somehow in that process, he found hunger and thirst. It was God at work, changing. Now, he always witnessed for Jesus. He always had that. He did that when he was 5 or 6 years old. He brought his friend to me one day playing outside. He said, and named him. He said, he wants to get saved. He'd done the preliminary work, I guess. And that was good. But when it came time to deal with his soul, to deal with God, to plan for his future, to live for Jesus, it took a work of the Word, the sword inside, opening him up, changing it. Most of us have had some of that experience. Somehow, I don't know how many people I've had the joy of pastoring who lived a long time without Jesus. They started in church and left church. And then somewhere down the line, they couldn't get away from the God who sometimes has been called the Hound of Heaven. Because you cannot get away from Him. Once God begins His work in you, you better just keep running if you don't want to get caught, because He's going to get you, and He's going to get you even if you're running. Because that's how God does it. He builds His church with people like that. If the Word dwells in us richly in all wisdom, as Paul wrote to the Colossians, and if we do not dull the edge of the knife by handling it wrong, by our own unworthy handling of it, we'll find it pierces to the dividing of my life right down to the core, the intentions of my heart. See, we can't know the intentions in another person's heart. God does. His word does. Separates, shakes, makes the word applicable, alive, where it can change our lives day after day after day. So we're told to take the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. What is needed necessarily is a simple act of yielding ourselves to Jesus and looking to Him only as our guide and strength. We're not going to be passive, but we're going to respond to the God who begins doing His work in us. The Holy Spirit who works in us enables us to understand the Word. The Holy Spirit helps us to interpret the Word aright and enables us to use the Word right. He uses all that as we live our life along the way. We take heed to the Word. We submit to the Word. We yield to the Word. Living Word, written Word, and we go out speaking the Word, and that spoken Word has power when the Spirit of God takes it and makes it alive. Don't try to be somebody you're not. Don't try to do what somebody else does. Find out who you are and live as you. I've been called every kind of preacher in the world. I've been named people that preach like. When I first started preaching, they thought I preached just like Billy Graham. I'll admit, I preached a lot of salvation sermons. It was saving day. People were getting saved week after week after week after week. And so you just pronounce the gospel and call them to come, and they did. But I've been called other things too, other preachers and less as well. J. Vernon McGee is the latest one. You know J. Vernon? Brethren, he's a West Texas boy, and I can't match what he talks or says. It's very different. But that came about because much of the time I just opened the scripture and work. I never did work it verse by verse. I just take sections and exposit that scripture, and so that seemed to be like him. So that's how I got that moniker. The Holy Spirit does God's bidding. He works from inside us. He works through us. He takes the Word of God. He supplies it so that we have a sword, which is the Word of God, always with us. When it's time to go out to battle, we pick the sword up. It's always there. Got the helmet on, got the sword in our hand. When I look at this list of things in Ephesians, these words are all significant words. Let me give them to you. Truth, righteousness, peace, faith, salvation, spirit. Those are all the parts. Those words are significant words to Christians. We run into them everywhere. From the belt of truth to the sword of the Spirit, the Word of God. Full armor. And where do you go when you get that done? What do you do next? Well, you're going to follow Paul's lead in the sixth chapter and pray. Because that's what the weapons are designed to help us do. Too much of the time, listen, too much of the time we go out to live for Jesus and serve Him and skip the place of prayer. And we go out without power, without focus, without clear instruction. I believe He can lead us. I believe He can, it's just like Madison was talking about, witnessing the students walking down a sidewalk. You go pick somebody out and go after them. Does the Holy Spirit lead people to do that? Yes, He does. And the beauty is, when you're ready to do that, and you go and do it, The work is already real in you, and you're ready to follow Jesus, whatever he asks. And God sends you to people that need him. We ought to think about all those things, probably. They're important. Because you and I together are witnesses for him. We are the bearers of the good news. We are accountable to the lost because we have the message they need. Everybody said, let's pray. Father, I want to thank you for the day. It's been a good day. Day of worship. Opportunity to sing some old songs that are full of fresh reminders of how precious and real and alive and grand Jesus is. Thank you, Father, for your blessing on your church, for your leadership in our lives. I thank you for your rich blessings today on each individual family and every single soul represented here. Use us this week, Lord. Draw us to the place of prayer. Work in our hearts and send us alive and attentive into the world where we are, where we live, where we work as a witness for you. Have your way with us in Jesus' name. Amen.